I've got the unenviable job of trying to keep you in the room and awake after a day of what can only be called professional level speakers. This was a great organizational job on behalf of Medline, and I appreciate the chance to be here. I've got a simple job. I don't have any great concepts or big ideas, just telling a story. I should mention that the person who really did all the work, Abby Stickley, is here, the nurse manager of the units where this took place. And she should really be giving this, but she saw Tom Daschle and Sue Kent and Dr. Trent and said, I'm not getting up there, you do it. Well, I have no pride, so I'm happy to do it. Let me just tell you a little bit for 30 seconds about where I'm coming from. I was a pulmonary critical care physician for 30 years at the bedside, getting every known fluid and some unknown fluids on me every day. And one of my last patients before I stopped doing that last year was a 67-year-old man who had an elective surgical procedure and ended up dying of a catheter-related urosepsis episode. So I came in loaded for bear, kind of outraged that these devices were being used so casually, and then I got to deal with the results. So that's the beginning. Let me get moving with the story here. This hospital, our hospital, is a big hospital. It's an inner city hospital. We do have an attached subacute facility with now 50 ventilators, and that becomes important to the story in a minute. This project took place on a definitive observation unit. Some people call them progressive care units. It's an ICU step-down unit, a 3-to-1 nursing ratio at this point. Very busy, total of 60 beds, no aides. Much to the RN's dismay. The background is that only 3 years ago, this was the worst rated unit in the hospital. We actually rate units. We ask physicians what they think of certain units. We even ask them why. This was the worst, and partly because of that, and partly for other reasons, the hospital changed ownership. There was a big turnover in 2007. We got a new manager who's here. The salaries were raised to attract, and it was successful. Really good nurses. We had a residency program. I'm not going to go into that, but it gave us a chance to see the nurses before we hired them. And we ended up with an amazing group of people. 27 years was the average age. And to me, that's childhood. The average tenure, I'm almost 40, you know? I mean, what's so funny about that? The average tenure was only 3 years. So this was a new group. We noticed in our subacute unit of all places, I was the medical director for the ventilator services there, and they routinely took out catheters when patients came in. It wasn't even a question, they just came out. I don't even think they needed an order. They just did it, and if the patient needed it back, well, maybe it went back. And they had noted no problems. The doctors were happy, the patients were happy, there were no big skin problems, and you know, I'm over in that unit where these are chronic patients and they have all their Foleys taken out. Now I'm in the ICU with this really high level of care and very well-trained people, and they're kept in. What's that all about? That was a little striking. And we found a gimmick, because this is a nursing culture issue, and I'll go into that in a minute. But you need a gimmick to get people interested, and the gimmick just kind of fell out of the sky. In the subacute unit, they were using paper. No special diapers or anything like that, just plain old paper pads. Well, I was fascinated by Pampers. When I had kids, I guess they were relatively new, little kids, and we played with these things. You can cut them with the scissors after they're wet and no water comes out. You can stomp on them and they stay solid. It was just an amazing thing. The background is interesting, and some people made a lot of money figuring out how to make these hydrogels, but to suffice it to say, as anybody who's used these or a Pampers diaper knows, when you get them wet, it takes a few minutes, but then they become a different material. They change phases, and they really are dry. So that was kind of cool. We called them super diapers. We'll sell that to Medline if you want. But nobody else, I don't think that's a trademark. That's our name, super diapers. The possibility of them eliminating Foleys did not go unrecognized. One of the initial objections was, gee, if you don't have a Foley in, how do you know the output? You don't know intake, well, you know the intake, but you don't know the output. Well, it's no big deal to weigh these things. There are cheap scales that do a good job, and that tells you the output, right? How much does 1 cc of liquid weigh? A gram? It's not a hard conversion. Not only that, but it catches things like sweat and even, I guess I can say it because it's long after lunch, diarrhea of all things. Even sweat, all kinds of wound exudates, that's all output, that counts, and that gets caught. So we convinced the doctors and the nurses that it might actually be a more accurate output than using that bag with the 100 cc gradations that everybody kind of rounds off. We also thought it might keep the skin and wounds even drier because it was absorbing everything, liquid right from the wounds. Obviously, reducing urinary tract infections was the big deal. It became a bigger deal when the knowledge that you aren't going to get paid for taking care of these if they occurred in the hospital occurred. So we had a very motivated administration at that point. We thought if you didn't get urosepsis, you aren't going to stay as long. I can't absolutely prove that, but it would be hard to argue, I think. Patient satisfaction, I've never met a patient who said, oh, please put the Foley back in. They don't like them. Even when they are wet, they don't like them. They're irritating. You feel like you have to urinate all the time. Everybody's seen the male patients especially who keep insisting they have to get up to go to the bathroom when they have a Foley in. It just feels like you have to go. And they end up sedated. And other things occur. Urethral trauma. People's urethras are irritated for days after a Foley. It itches. They feel urgency. It's not a pleasant thing. My career was taking care of ARDS patients and trying to avoid nosocomial pneumonias. The big friend of a nosocomial pneumonia is sedation. And a lot of our patients need sedation just so they won't pull the Foley out. The restraints are another result of having Foleys in. And if you wanted to design a system to give a patient a pneumonia, it would be to put them in the only position mammals never voluntarily attain, and that is supine. We make them stay supine. We strap them down if they won't stay supine. And the mechanical disadvantage of the lung, I'll give my respiratory physiology lecture here if I'm not careful. But there are a lot of secondary advantages to not having these. Nobody's gonna argue with that, I don't think. When do you need a Foley? We developed a list. I don't think it's even ours. It's a standardized list of reasons you really might have to have a Foley catheter, and obviously obstruction. If you have a prostatic hypertrophy or whatever that's obstructing urinary outflow, well, you gotta have a Foley. There's just not really any way around it. The doctor orders hourly I's and O's. We don't feel that we can ask the nurses to change the diaper every hour and weigh it. I mean, in theory, yeah, you could do that, but that's not gonna happen. In consultation with our wound care nurse, and yes, we have an honest to God wound care nurse, who incidentally has veto power. If we take a Foley out and she says, no, it has to go in, it's automatic. Nobody argues with her. She's never done it once, but she has that power. We agreed that if you had a stage 3 or 4 decubitus, skin broken, and an active urinary tract infection, pyuria and bacteria growing on a culture, not just, maybe it's not just right, but it had to be a proven urinary tract infection, we would go for the Foley. I'm backing off on that a little bit, because a lot of the wound care nurses I talk to say, oh no, you don't even need one then, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes. We don't argue with urologists. If a urologist says he needs a Foley, nobody says boo, they get the Foley. So those are the four things. We have a fifth, maybe, that I'll talk about. Well, everyone wants to know, yeah, well, that's great. We all agree with that, but what do you do? Well, we realized, and I'm sure most of you realize it too, that nobody wants a Foley other than the nurse. The patients really don't want it. The doctors don't want it. The nurse wants it. So this is a nursing culture issue, and the game became, how do you change the nursing culture? And I was so new at this, I didn't know you couldn't do it. And Abby certainly thought you could do it. So we had a little bit of luck there. Again, urologists are an exception. As has been said earlier today, most Foleys are placed in the ER or the OR, and then it's not the floor nurse's problem. I didn't put it in. I don't have to do anything. So it stays in, and it's nice, it's sanitary, you don't have to worry about urine, it's kind of the way everybody was trained, and it just seems natural. But there are no criteria usually. It's a routine kind of nursing culture thing, and that's why they're in, when you come right down to it. Well, how do you get that culture changed? It's not an easy issue. And we had a lot of fun with it, because we had such a young group, and I'll include myself. I mean, I was young at the job at the time. We went to a lot of trouble to let the nurses know that probably the deadliest device they'll ever handle in their life isn't a gun, or a car for that matter, It's one of those catheters. And we point out that if you take deaths from AIDS, breast cancer, and automobile accidents and add them up, a Foley's still more deadly. And that had a sobering effect. We convinced them that it was a sign of nursing excellence to get the catheter out. Anyone can leave it in, but a really excellent nurse will take the initiative and initiate its removal.